Okay, तो we'll start with today's session, guys. Just give me quick confirmation you are able to hear me properly and you are able to see the slides. You can just type yes in the chat window. Okay. Okay, many are saying yes. Now we will start with today's session. Meantime, others will join. Okay. Very good evening, all of you. Hope you all are well. Now, before starting with today's session, I'll just like try to give you one short introduction about myself, and then we will dive into TYBCS syllabus, and then any one of that subject will first start. Other subjects also we are going to take, don't worry. So one by one, as many subjects are possible from my side, I'll try to cover. Okay. So again, very good evening. Hope you all are well. Quick introduction, this side, myself, Ajit More. I'm located in Akurdi Pradhikaran. Many of you know me, many of my students know me. But now in this session, many of them have joined from many different places. I guess many are from Baramati also, some are from Kopargaon, and I just saw the registrations, so from Malegaon and all. So many places people have joined. So those who are from nearby colleges, they know me. So just a short introduction about myself. So as I said, this side, myself, Ajit More. I'm located in Akurdi Pradhikaran, Pune. By qualification, I am BE Computers from University of Pune. I've completed my Bachelor's of Engineering in Computers. And work professional, I'm into software training from around past 23 years, from around 1998, when I guess you were not even born. Many of the students in this batch which are attending the session, many of them might have not been born also. So in around 1998, I started with software training profession, and since then I'm teaching varied subjects to BCS, BCA, even MCS, MCA, and major I started my career with engineering courses. I used to teach major to engineering people, and then I started with these other courses also. Okay. Then I have published different books for engineering, even for computer science BCS people also, in subjects like data structure, mainly data structure, then theory of computation, and some programming languages also. Okay. Then the subject of interest, the main subjects. My main subjects are programming. All the programming languages, like started with Pascal, Fortran, and all, then C, C++, Java, PHP, and nowadays I'm conducting some Kotlin, Go programming, okay, even Dart programming and all. So all programming languages are mainly my subject of interest. Okay. Main career I started with C, C++, then gradually I moved to Java, PHP and all. Python, from last 1 year I've been conducting Python online. Maximum students have studied Python from me online. Then even for analytics and all, I'm using R. For for mobile applications and all, Dart, Kotlin and all. So these different languages are there. Then other add-on subjects like data structures, then design analysis of algorithms, then even operating system, principles of programming practices, theory of computation, all these add-on subjects also I keep teaching according to the requirement. And I go to many colleges for value addition. Many colleges have, like in Pune also, and even nearby DY Patil and all. So I go for value addition subjects. Now last year I was teaching them Python, R and all, even HTML, Angular, lot of value addition subjects I have taught like. And even I was for faculty development program for Pune University students of BCA, for BCA student, BCA faculties of all Pune University. I was there for that Angular subject, AngularJS. And I teach Vedic mathematics as a hobby. It's not a profession, as a hobby. So if you go to my YouTube channel, you'll see one series of Vedic sessions also. So if you're interested, you can go there. You can watch that sessions as well. Okay. So this was a short introduction about myself. I hope many might be knowing, as I said, many of my students, those who are nearby, those who already attend sessions, they know about me. But I just thought of many other people are joining from many outskirts and outside Pune also. So they need to know. So just a short introduction. And even for corporate training and all also, I keep going. Now I'll just quickly give you a overview about what subjects you have in your third year BCS, that is third year computer science, first semester. Okay, that is your fourth and fifth and sixth semester. So first group is these are all your discipline specific, like your discipline is computer science. So computer science specific, that is discipline specific compulsory subjects. So there are three groups and every group is having three subjects. Okay, and then last two subjects are there which are your skill enhancement compulsory subjects. Okay, so total actually you have 11 subjects, but my dear students, according to the timing, we are actually conducting 1.5 hour, and for whole semester in 1.5 hour, ideally it is difficult, but as much as possible, keep faith on me, as much as possible from my side, I'll try to cover like, okay, the maximum subjects which are possible from my side, I'll try to deliver to you people, get it? But as I said, no assurance about each and every subject, because as the timing factor is very important. So in this first group of your discipline specific compulsory courses, one is your operating system. So if this operating system subject, if I'm not able to cover, so at least I'll cover your numericals, at least problems, at least I'll tell you, or the practicals which are based on it, that at least I'll try to cover. Then computer network, this is purely theoretical subject. Okay, by mistake I wrote here two, it is actually one, very sorry for that. And then one practical course which is based on that first subject. Okay, so there are many C programs, so obviously C data structure you need to recall, so some C programs are there based on your operating system simulation, many simulations you have to do, getting memory management simulation, then simulations for CPU scheduling, okay, then your directory structure simulation. So for that some C programs you have to develop, that is one separate practical. Then the second discipline specific group, in which one is your web technologies. In this one, complete new programming language you will be learning, that is PHP. Okay, so initially some introduction of HTML, CSS and all will be doing it, and then we will dive into one programming language, that is PHP. Okay, and very useful a PHP for web development. Like those who are interested to enter into web development, like there are many frameworks which companies are needing, and there are lot need for that frameworks, like Laravel. I hope you might have heard about Laravel and all. So Laravel is a framework based on PHP. So to learn Laravel framework, you need to know PHP. I think that is a requirement. Then this is also going to have a very big opportunity to you. If you are good in data science concepts, the foundation of data science, this is a booming field now, around 344% growth in the field of data science they are seeing in the near future. But again, you need to have some good understanding about statistics and all. If you have done it very well in your first year BCS, so if your statistics, some part of your computational geometry and all, so that will need, and even some database management system knowledge, DBMS knowledge, SQL, Postgres and all you have studied. So if you have that good understanding, this will be a very easy going for you people. And then another practical is based on these two things, getting this web technology and data science. So they are going to conduct one practical based on this both. Then we have a third discipline specific group in which one paper is there, that is object-oriented programming using Java. So again, a new language is coming into your knowledge, because till now you had learned in the past 2 years C, somewhat about Python maybe for electronics, but major C only. Now you'll be learning C, one new language is coming, PHP in your knowledge. Then Java you'll be learning. So object-oriented programming using Java. Java is also in demand. Okay, many people are still getting good jobs on the basis of Java. Then second is a theoretical computer science subject. This is completely a problem-based subject. It's a mathematical subject and very scoring. Many of my students have got full marks like. They have got full in the past years like. Okay, many are there those who have got complete marks in this subject like. So it's a complete problem-oriented subject. Very scoring, very interesting. Getting? So I plan to teach this subject, some programming languages I'll try to teach, okay, and the other, if possible, sure, we'll take that too. And a practical which is based on this both, okay. And last are your skill enhancement. There are two skill enhancement compulsory subject in which they have added Python programming. Now they have not kept practical on this, but they are saying that when you're learning it, some percentage should be given to programming. Okay? And one last is your blockchain concept. Okay? The blockchain is a complete new technology only. If you have heard about cryptocurrency and all, ethers and ripples and all, how they are based on this cryptocurrency concept, all that models you'll come to know later. So total 11 subjects you have, and they are all of 2 credit, means total 22 credit your courses, right? So if you have got a quick overview about this course, what all the subjects you are going to do it in TYBCS, and how many credits each subject is having, so just quick confirmation you can give me, getting? And then we will start with, now what we'll do is we'll start with one Java, then meantime we'll keep doing that too. And the other subjects also will try to start. Like at least I'll take this theoretical computer science. It's a scoring subject. No? So as many examples, problems you'll solve, you'll be more confident. You'll score good in it, like, get it? And even other like PHP, I'll try to cover PHP. If possible, I'll tell you about data science concepts also. Get it? So whatever is possible from my side, I'll tell you. Right, guys? So I'm just expecting confirmation from you guys. Just tell me, is the course overview clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Sure? Okay. Even in the chat window, if you type, because now the count is too big, so I cannot personally hear everyone. I'll just see it in the chat window. Okay, good. Many are saying yes. Good. And I'm sure you are excited to learn all this thing. And I am also super excited to teach you all this thing. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll start with Java programming, that is object-oriented programming using Java. And all these programming languages, they have practicals. So I'll cover their practicals as well. Don't worry for that. Okay, so now shall we start with it? Just quickly type yes or no. Okay, good. Many have network issue, many are getting connected, disconnected. Close with this, and then we will start with Right? So we will start with object-oriented programming using Java. And then we have object-oriented programming using Java paper 2 also in semester 2, the second part of it. Okay? I'll just quickly give you course outline. How many chapters are there in this Java programming? Okay? They have divided your whole Java, basic Java course into 5 chapters. The first chapter is Introduction to Java. So in this we'll learn history of Java. Okay, I'm sure many are not interested in hearing history, but you have to, because many times MCQs and all are based on it. So history, then object-oriented programming concepts, then we'll learn buzzwords of Java, that is features of Java. Then we'll learn how to write first Java program. Okay, and then for running that Java program, we'll need some tools. So what the tools are there. And then all the elementary programming concepts will be learned. Elementary things like identifiers, keywords, data types, operators, control structures, arrays. Getting everything is covered in this one chapter only. Pune University is expecting you people are super intelligent. And just imagine 11 subjects in one semester. The old course was not having these many. They were having only 6 subjects. Getting just double the subjects they have done. Ideally, I don't know what is the expectation. But now you have to make yourself smart. And I'm sure you are already. Getting? You have to work a little bit more. Not that difficult. So in this first chapter, as I said, history, features, OOP concepts, first Java program, then all the elementary things like identifiers, keywords, operators, control structures, then arrays, all that we'll learn in this first chapter. Then second chapter is specially devoted for what are objects and what are classes. So how to create class, then how to create copies of that class called as object. Then all the other concerned topics like constructors, overloading, getting, and then all ready-made classes which Java has provided. Java has provided many ready-made classes. So we'll use that ready-made classes like string, string buffer and all. Then what is a package? Then how to create your package? All this will be learning in this chapter 2. Okay? Then chapter 3 is for inheritance and interfaces. Like those who already have some knowledge about C++, so they might be knowing about inheritance. Or I guess these all concepts in object-oriented software engineering also you have studied in last year. In OOS also you might have studied. I'm sure like in UML diagrams and all these terminologies you have studied. But anyways, I'll take one topic in which I cover all the object-oriented programming concepts also. Don't worry. So inheritance, then types of inheritance, what is interface? Interface C++ doesn't provide. It's a Java feature. Whereas inheritance is there in C++ as well. Then how to write a robust code, how to write a foolproof code by using exception handling mechanism. So in this we'll be learning how to write a try-catch block, and using try-catch, how we can make the script, your Java code, a robust code. And then file handling. File handling is the vital part of every programming language. Like in every programming language, you need to study file handling. Okay, right? So how to open file, how to write within the file, lot of things, how to read from the file, all that concepts. And this fifth chapter will be very much useful for your projects. Because in semester 2, in your skill enhancement course, one subject for 2 credit, they have kept project. Okay, so for project, you'll need this chapter, very important chapter it is. But again, those people who are going to develop project in Java, those who are going to develop in PHP, so they won't need it. So in this, we'll learn how to create GUI applications. GUI, that is graphical user interface. So how to develop GUI applications, that you'll learn here. Means how you'll create your window and then design that window and then handle events in it. like buttons, text box, radio buttons, check boxes, list box, scroll bar, all the things you'll use and design your GUI, and then handle user interaction also. Getting events also, how to handle it. So all that we'll be learning in this chapter. Okay, so this way, these five chapters are there in your first semester Java course. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll start with the first chapter. What do you say, guys? Quick confirmation from anyone, you can give me the confirmation.
Yes,
Students are still joining. Still joining. Because I have already told you, the class starts at 6 o'clock. Please join on time. And some are joining, but some are leaving also. Anyways. Okay. Good. So let's move on to the history part. Quickly, we will start with the first chapter. Okay. And in that first chapter, one important topic we have to learn, that is history. Then we will learn object-oriented programming concepts also. Then features of Java. Everything line by line will go, don't worry. First, we'll start with the history. Okay, history of Java. But before that, I want to tell you something about this company, this organization, okay, based in USA, Santa Carla, Sun Microsystem. I don't know how many of you have heard about it. Sun Microsystems. It's a company based in Santa Carla, California, USA. Now it has been collaborated with Oracle. Oracle is also has taken over. So now it's a collab between Oracle and Sun. So now generally, if you go to Sun's official website, their Oracle name is also attached. So now it has become Oracle Sun Microsystems. Getting? So this is one organization which has come with their own hardware. Hardware means their own processor, because normally in processor making, only Intel is one of the company, and then other Cyrix, AMD, and many more are there. But commonly, when we say a processor, so always in our brain, Intel is one common name. But Sun Microsystem has designed their processor also, and that processor is called as a Spark processor. Getting? Spark for scalable architecture. Scalable architecture. Scalable processor architecture. Now we'll say scalable meaning what? Getting? So the concept of scalable meaning, the architecture is having many number of processors, and the mesh of that processor you can adjust. Means especially it is for mainframes, or you can call it as a supercomputers. Means they came with this processor for, not for your common laptops, and it is not meant for your normal PCs. It is for supercomputer architecture. And you know that in supercomputer, there is no one processor. One processor is also called as a core. I hope you know. Core means a execution unit. One execution unit is called as one core. Getting? And there is chances, in one core there can be two CPUs also. One CPU, two CPU. So two CPU fabricated in one unit, you can call it as one core. So generally, if there are two core, then we call it as dual core. So these are the processors, many processors. May there are hundreds and thousands of processors, and they are connected with each other. So they have a mesh system. There can be different architectures. So mesh is there, star is there, irregular system, many topologies they use. So this mesh, you can scale, you can grow it, you can reduce it. If you want, you can reduce it. If you want, you can grow it. That is the main benefit of that scalable architecture. So why they call it as scalable, I hope you got it. So as I said, this system has come with their own processor. This organization has come with their own processor. Getting? That is called a Spark processor, scalable processor architecture. Now there are many, like first was Spark, then Ultra Spark, then Super Spark. Many generations came in it later. Okay, to Spark, then Super Spark, then Ultra Spark. And this processor is specially for supercomputers only. And I hope you know what is a supercomputer. I cannot go into that detail now. Getting no? What is a supercomputer? I hope you know. Is Pune also known for its own supercomputer? Do you know? We are from Pune and we should be proud of it. Does anyone know? Huh.
Yes, sir.
Yes?
Pune has its own supercomputer.
Do you know about it? The name of it?
Sir, I don't know in detail, but I know that they have developed their own computer, and Pune has
Yes,
is
clear. It has been developed in Pune University, SIDAC.
university. Yes.
I hope you know this SIDAC Center. Clear? So the Center for Advanced Development and Computing. So if you go for if you can plan doing courses in SIDAC also. So SIDAC has come with their own processor, and it's called as Param computer. Param 9000, Param 10000. So it is also a supercomputer only. And they also developed it with why? Because US was not exporting. Now, US was not ready to give their supercomputers to us. So therefore, our scientists decided that we will come with our supercomputer. And then now we export it. Now we give them. Clear? So Param computer, Param 9000 and all, they are all developed in our Pune University, like, okay? So therefore, you should be proud that you are doing graduation in Pune University.
सर
Getting you.
आयआयटीएम ला जाणार आहे ना ते
Pardon, pardon.
आयआयटीएम
But the initial thing is with the SIDAC people only. That's a design hai. It's design. Later that development can be done, ते तिकडे झाला असेल, but the design was in that SIDAC. Getting, no, what I'm saying? Means the initial design part was over there. And you can see that Param computers also, like one day they keep open in Pune University. So if you go to that center, no, you can see that computers. They are huge cupboard size, big room size they occupy. And they show also to we people. Now it's not there, but previously there was one day where university was open to all. So that time you can see that Param computers there. So one processor is designed by the Sun people, but then the second thing which they came with, that is one hardware that you got it. The second thing they came with was their own operating system. So purposely, like many may think that why he's about to tell the Java history, so why he is telling this? So purposely, because Java is developed by Sun Microsystem, but Sun Microsystem has come with all this. So I was supposed to tell you that Sun Microsystem has designed their scalable processor architecture. Sun Microsystem came with their OS also. Getting? They have come with their operating system. Getting? And that is known as Sun Solarisys. You can download their image also. It's freely available because anyway it's open source. So you can download that image, and if you're using VirtualBox in your system, like VMware or VirtualBox, so in that you can use this Sun Solarisys OS. It's very much like Red Hat and all, like Kali Linux or Red Hat, if you have used, very much the same, because its main architecture is taken from Unix operating system. And the specialty of that is it's a multi user operating system. Okay? And it's a time shared operating system. So we many time call it as Unix Solarisys. Now there's one more distributive of it called as an Open Solarisys. I said, like, you can download their image, you can use that image in your system. Okay? If you have VMware, you can put it and start using it. Nothing different, like it's very much same like Red Hat and all. Okay, so as I said, this operating system is multi-user operating system, open source. Open source means it they have given it along with the source code. Open source means not free, just remember. Clear? Open source means it has come along with the source code. And if you are competent C programmer, because they have developed it in C language, some part is in assembly, but major is in C. So if you are competent C programmer, you can study it. You can open it, you can study it. Even original Unix also is available. There's one book of Robert Love. Robert Love, his book is there, and in that 10,000 lines of whole Unix code they have explained. And then you'll realize the power of C, getting the C language. And as I said, the original kernel of this Solaris is Unix only. The main architecture, the design is of Unix only, like, getting? Only Unix is not free, Solaris is free. Open Solaris is free. Unix never come free, okay? And the third thing which they developed is Java programming language. So we are going to talk about Java in detail. Its history is also going to take one complete lecture, don't worry. But Java is one programming language which the Sun people developed. Java is an object-oriented programming language. Okay. Now remember, all programming languages follow their paradigms. Paradigms means approach of writing code. Okay. So there are some structured scripting languages, languages in which just you write script one after another and it gets executed. So there are procedure-oriented languages like C, Pascal, and all, where we write functions. Getting? We write functions, means we divide our problem into smaller problem, write functions for them, and then we call that functions any number of time. So it's a procedure-oriented. And object-oriented programming is also one paradigm. Paradigm means approach. So in OOP approach, a different concept is there, where we group related data, related functions, related functions into one capsule called as a class, and then we create copies of that class. So therefore, it's called as an object-oriented. So we will talk on it, don't worry. We'll come to one topic called object-oriented concepts. In that, I'll tell you in detail about what is a class, what is an object, everything. What is inheritance, what is polymorphism, all I'll tell you. Don't worry. Okay? So it is an object-oriented language, multi-purpose, means it is not for some specific domain. You can use it for standalone applications, desktop applications, web applications, database applications, for controlling hardware, mobile applications, nearly everything you can develop using Java. And the very, very important feature of Java is it is platform independent. Platform independent principle, just now you just remember, compile once and run anywhere. See, the principle is what? Compile once, and once you compile it, you'll get a Java executable called as a bytecode. And that bytecode you can run anywhere in any systems. Means let it be a Mac system, let it be a Windows system, let it be a Linux system. That is Unix system. So let the system be anything. The same compiled code you can run on any platform. That is the very big advantage of Java. Getting? And that's the reason then Java became language of internet. Why it is a language of internet? Because of this platform independent. Because internet is a connection of heterogeneous machine. Are all the machines in the internet same? No. Getting? So I hope you got it. What you got to know about Sun Solarises is clear. Sun Solarises is one organization which has come with their own processor, they have come with their own OS, and they have come with their own language as well. Clear? Okay, so till here, I hope that everything is fine. Right, guys? Keep giving me confirmation, because otherwise, like, I won't come to know. Okay,
Yes, sir.
let me see the okay, let me see the chat window. Okay. No issues. Now let's see the history part of Java, like how Java came into existence. Okay, so around 70s C came, right or no? 73 and all. Then after one decade, complete one decade, that is around 83, C++ came. And after complete one decade, around 93, Java came. Officially 95, initially 93, and the work started in around 90. Okay. So in around 1990, at Sun Microsystem, hear carefully. I'm sure history part is a little bit boring, but hear it. It will be really useful for your interviews also to solve your multiple choice questions. Okay? And it will be useful to tell to someone also. Right? So around 1990, James Gosling and his team of people, many more were there, Jonathan, then Patrick Norton and Bill Joy, many other. They were all his team member, and they all are working in Sun Microsystem. Okay, so around 1990 at Sun Microsystem, James Gosling and his team of people, they were assigned with one task. Getting guys, they were given with one task, one project. And the task was to write a software which will control electronic devices. You understanding what I'm saying? They were supposed to write a software which will control different electronic devices. Now that controlling can be done through touch panels or through remote. But through remote or through touch panel, if you want to control that device, obviously you need to write some software with which that device can be controlled. So, what was their task given? As I said, they were told not only James, he was the main member of that team, but other were also the role players. Others also were the contributors in making of Java. So, James Gosling and his team were given a task to write a software which will control electronic devices. Getting? And that software, as I said, which will control the device using what? Either through the remote or through touch panels. Like if you have at your home microwave ovens and all, so they are touch based. Nowadays, refrigerators and all, they also have come in a touch based way. Correct? Like you have an refrigerator is one thing, then even your television system. Or you have air conditioners, so they are controlled through the remote and all. Now through Bluetooth, you control it through your cell phones also. So different electronic devices are there, and they were told to write a software which will control this electronic devices. Getting? Now this team thought of using C++ for writing this software. Okay, have patience, hear me carefully. Okay, so they thought of using C++, and this project name was given as a green project. The project name was called as a green project, and their team name was called as a green team. Now there is a history behind that also, why they gave name green project. So at this moment I will not tell about that. Now if you are really curious, you'll explore it. I'm sure about it. Clear? If you are really curious about it, why they gave the name green project only, so you can find out. The team name was Green Team, and as I said, they thought of using which language? C++. Okay, because C++ was in boom at that time. Because one decade, 10 years back, C++ was already developed, and C++ was object-oriented programming language. So, because of that OOP nature, they thought of why not to use C++? And C++ was having one benefit that we can control hardwares and all through it. So they thought of using C++. So initial language to develop software, they thought of C++. But soon, when they decided, they highlighted or they spotted out some drawbacks of this language. Okay? So they thought of using C++ because it was an object-oriented programming language. But soon they found out some drawbacks. Now, what the drawbacks are, that we are going to discuss now one by one. Okay, we will discuss about the drawbacks. But the drawbacks made them to think about some other language. Okay? And instead of going for other language, they designed their own language only. Getting or no? So they found out some drawbacks in C++. Now what we'll do is we will discuss about the drawbacks, okay, and why that drawbacks or why they were the problems in their project. That too I'll tell you. Okay, means in development of this project, why those all problems of C++ are going to be problem in their project. So that too I'll convey. Okay, so till here I hope you got it. So as I said that at 1990, around 1990 at Sun Microsystem, and that's the reason I referred the name Sun Microsystem. So you should know what, who is, which is that organization and what they have come with. So that's the reason on the previous slide I told you. They came with the language, they came with the processor, they came with their OS. Okay, so at 1990, Sun Microsystem, James Gosling and his team, they were given with the task to write a program which will control electronic devices. That program will control electronic device, but that devices should be controlled with a remote or a touch panel. The project name was given Green Project, and they thought of using C++ because of OP nature, but soon they found out some drawbacks in it. Now, what are that drawbacks? So the main drawbacks I'm going to highlight. Okay, guys, clear? I'm sure you are hearing me. The mode of conduct is online. Getting? When it is an offline, so there is a direct eye-to-eye contact. I come to know whether you are understanding or no. But then there
Yes,
is
sir.
no option, right? So I'm sure you all are hearing me carefully. Okay, and
Yes, sir.
I'm happy to see that so many students have joined, and so many are keen to learn. Okay, so take the best of it, take the advantage of it. Right? I'm sure you'll take the benefit of all the knowledge sharing. What the drawbacks are, that we'll see. But before that, I'll just show you the team. Okay? In this team, few members, the green team member, he's James Gosling. He was the main one to design the language, the core person in designing that language. Then Patrick Norton, Mike Sheridan, Bill Joy. Jonathan, he's Bill Joy. Now, all names I'm not giving, the main I'm giving. Okay, Bill Joy has come with his own scripting language already. He was the part of Unix making also. Unix making, he was the member of Unix making also in AT&T Bell Labs. Okay, so he has come with his own scripting language also called as a C shell script. So that shell scripting is his invention. So all these were the members, and everyone were given some task like language selection for the project, for that green project, which language to select. That was the task given to him. Mike Sheridan was given for business development. Getting the part of how to make that product famous. Okay. Then graphics of that software, whatever software they were going to make. So the interface, you can say the interface of that software, that was the task given to him. So everyone was given some task or the other. The main things I have highlighted. Now we will quickly discuss about what were the drawbacks, okay, of C++, which forced them to come with the new language. Okay. Now the first drawback is multiple inheritance. Now actually, if you are aware with C++, then okay. Right? But if not, so we are going to learn all the object-oriented programming concepts. So in that, I'll be telling you about inheritance. Now just remember, inheritance means mechanism of creating one class from another class. Means someone has already developed a class. So why to start everything from the scratch? You understanding or no? Getting? Already someone has developed a class. Like example you take, someone has developed a class button. Now I want a blink button. Blink button. Now blink button is also a type of button only. Means it needs the functionality of button with the extra facility of blinking. So Shall I start from the scratch or can I use this ready class which has already developed by someone? So someone has already developed, tested, debugged, it's already error-free. Reuse it and create your new class. And in that new class, you add the add-on features of that blinking, and you will get everything from that parent also. So everything from the parent will come and you can add your feature. So inheritance mechanism is in real life also, no? In real life also, we inherit lot of things from our parent. Yes or no? Look come from mother, intelligence come from father. Many will say, no, sir, nothing like that. Our father is also good at looking, and my mother is also intelligent. It is just a general statement, I said. Getting? So do we many times inherit lot of things from our parent? Many times parent make good bank balance, parents good make good house and all. So everything comes to us, no? And we add some extra thing also in it. We also add something and we reuse something. So that is the concept called inheritance. Now, in inheritance only, there is one type called as a multiple inheritance. Multiple inheritance meaning when you are creating one class from more than one parent class. See here. Means you are going to get the feature of this parent also and that parent, and you will add your own. So from more than one parent, when a new child is created, it's called as a multiple. And suppose from one parent, many child, so it's called as a hierarchical inheritance. Hierarchy. Getting? Like a BCA student and BCS student. Both are types of student. So here we have student, and BCA is a type of student. BCS is a type of student. You understanding? So there is a hierarchical inheritance in the upside, multiple inheritance bottom side. Now, if such situation come, getting? So that is called as a diamond problem. And that diamond situation is a problem. Why it is a problem? That I'll tell you. See here, this is the situation. You understanding? This is actually called as a famous diamond problem. Common interview question. Commonly in interviews they ask, do you know anything about diamond problem? Okay. So it is a situation of diamond, no? Like one parent, many child. It's a hierarchical inheritance. From many child, many parent, single child, it's called as a multiple. Now you may ask like why it is a problem. So what happens is this common parent A is getting replicated, okay, twice when it reaches to D. When it reaches to D, it is reaching twice from B path also and C path also. Because A is available for B, A is available for C, and now they both are available to D. So A reaches to D how many times? Twice. Through this path also and through this path. So there is a wastage of memory. Getting? So as I said, there is a wastage, there is duplicacy of this A in D. In D, A gets duplicated how many times? As many path are there. So here there are two path, so two time. If suppose there is a third path, three time. Getting? Now to overcome that, language C++ has given solution. You understanding, guys? They have a given a solution, but that solution is increasing complexity to the compiler. They have given a concept called virtual base class, but it is a burden to the internal burden to your system. Okay, so that is one drawback which was highlighted by whom? That was a drawback highlighted by this James Gosling and this team in C++ language. Okay, so at least basic idea you got it. What might be the problem in this? Yes, guys.
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
The basic problem you might have got in this situation, such diamond situation, A is getting replicated twice. Means when it reaches to D, it is reaching twice. So there is a wastage. That many times it is duplicated in memory. Solution is there, but it is complex. Getting? So therefore, Java-like language doesn't support only. In Java, such multiple inheritance doesn't come. There is no such facility given. Then second important drawback of C++, which they highlighted, That is memory leaks. I'm sure about memory leaks you have heard about it in C only, when you might have studied C in dynamic memory management. Sure, in dynamic memory management you have studied it. Okay. Still, we'll come to it. In short, I'll just tell you, memory leaks means, and memory leaks is associated with dynamic memory. And dynamic memory is handled from heap. I hope you know it. Every program is having four sections. Like any of you are attending now, those who are my students, I'm sure you might be knowing it. Clear?
Yes, sir.
It is having four sections. There is a text section, code section. There is a data section where global is kept, heap section where runtime data is kept, and all your local variables, parameters, local variable that is kept on a stack. So this memory, we are talking about this heap memory. Okay, so memory leaks means what? The memory which is neither freed nor accessible. Means it is not freed also. Freed means you are not given it to the system back. And we are not telling the system, please utilize it for other work. Please reutilize it for other work. Okay? So that also you have not informed. And you are also not accessing because you have lost its address. Hear carefully what I'm saying. You have lost its address. Therefore, it's not accessible to you. And it is not given back to the system also. You understanding? And you have not informed to the OS that please take this memory and utilize it for other purpose. So when it is not freed also and it is not accessible also, then it is called as a memory leak. Getting? There is a common name, common proverb in Marathi. Na mala, na tula, ghal kutrela. Getting? And those who are Marathi, they might be knowing it.
Yes,
Clear?
sir.
To you are also not utilizing it. And you're not giving it to someone else also to utilize. Getting? But now you will say, why this leaks problem occur? Because in C++ and even in C, memory doesn't get freed automatically. Means in short, is the garbage collection automatic? No. Clear? You have to release the memory explicitly. Which memory? Dynamic memory. So now with an example, I'll tell you. See, p is an integer pointer. Okay, no worries. Your semicolon is missing. Don't try to find out such mistakes. So integer star p semicolon. So p is a pointer, right? Now we have allocated one integer on heap. On heap, one integer memory means as much memory is needed for one integer, like 4 bytes. So 4 byte integer, and in that memory, 10 is stored. And the address of that memory is collected in P. Getting? Pictorially, I'll try to show. So P is on the stack, and that integer, one integer with value 10, is on the heap. Remember, they both their positions are different. That one integer with value 10, which we have runtime allocated, that is on the heap. And that variable in which that address will be kept, is it supposed to be a pointer only? Obviously. In what we keep the address, that is very basic for you people. Address is to be kept in a pointer only. So that pointer is on a stack. Getting guys? So P is pointing to that integer, which is having value 10. After some time, after some subsequent step, what I do is I allocate again a new integer. See a P equal to new int with a value 50. Now what will happen? Will it allocate a new integer with a value 50?
Address
Yes or
lock.
no, guys? Clear? We'll come to it. Correct? I'm sure you are, those who are answering means they have attended somewhere in the past my C sessions or something.
Yes, sir.
So,
Yes.
is it going to allocate one integer with a value 50? Yes. And its address will be stored now in P. But when this new memory address is stored in P, is the old address lost? Obviously, it is overwritten. So when that new address is overwritten on the previous one, the previous address is lost. Getting? So now, can we access this old memory? No, because we don't have address. As the address from us is lost, we cannot access it. You're understanding or no? Clear? Okay. Such unclaimed concept, the common in real life things I'll tell you, like LIC, Life Insurance Corporation, they have clear crores of amount which is unclaimed. Means there are many people, those who take policy, okay, but unfortunately if they die, so no one go and claim for that. So it remains unclaimed only with Life Insurance Corporation. You understanding? It is a very common example. You can relate that. So such money is never been utilized by anyone. Getting? The owner is also not claiming it, and it is not free to anyone else also because it is someone else. Getting? So what happens is that such type of memory remains, such type of money remains unclaimed. This is the situation. You understanding? The new memory allocated, its address is stored in P, the old address is gone, okay? But this memory is unaccessible, but it is not freed also. The situation is, this memory is not put into the free list. It is not given back to the system. You understanding, guys? This memory is not given back to the system also. Because language like C++ doesn't do automatic garbage collection. In language like C++ or C, because C is also based on C++ only. Other way you should say, C++ is based on C only. So what happens is, this memory we are not accessing because we don't have address, and it is not given back to the OS also. And it is not put into the free list. Because if it is put in a free list, can OS give it to someone else? Yes, indeed. Okay, so that is not happening. And therefore, such memory is called as a leak. See, not freed, not accessible. It is not even freed and not even accessible. So what we were supposed to do between these two lines, first allocation, second allocation. So before doing second allocation, just before it, were we supposed to write free P? In C, we write free P. In C++, we write delete P. Yes or no? So we were supposed to write here free P so that that memory will be put into a free list, in garbage list. And once it goes in a free list, system can reutilize it. So we forgot to do it. Getting? We directly allocated new memory. So that is also drawback. Means we want a language in which this should happen automatic. You understanding? The moment your reference goes to someone else, the old one should be automatically put into free list. You understanding or no? Clear? When you go to movies and all, or you go to big hospitals and malls, so there is a housekeeping team, no? You can see, and they periodically come to do the cleaning. Because we are uncivilized, no? We do a lot of all the garbage and all we keep throwing in the movie halls and all popcorns and everything we throw. So when the movie is over, so do the housekeeping team come with a vacuum cleaner and they clean everything? So there the automatic cleaning is there. Are we supposed to clean everything and go? No, because we are shameless, no? We go as it is. And everything which is put over there, that housekeeping team come and then they have to clean it. Same thing. We want a language which will do the garbage collection automatic. And that was not possible in C++. Getting? So I hope this problem is also clear. Yes, guys?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sure. Others also. Many are there. Now so many
Yes,
people
sir.
are there joining. Okay. Good. Okay? Many people are there, those who have joined the session. So please respond. Okay. So now multiple inheritance is clear, memory leaks is clear. Okay. Coming to the third concept, that is architecture and platform dependent. Okay. So language like C, language like C++, they are platform dependent, architecture dependent. Getting? Architecture means the processors which you use. Like, if it is from an Intel family, then it is okay. But totally another architecture. Like if it is a Motorola 6800 processor, so the design is totally different. Or some supercomputer architecture or Intel architecture. So their internal architectures are totally different. So you cannot move the program from one architecture to another. And the platforms, that is your OS. Getting? Like we are on Windows, we are on Linux, or we are on Macintosh. So suppose if I have written one, this is a Windows-based system, and I have written a C++ program, which is applicable for C also. Remember, every C++ program is ultimately converted into C. So first C dot CPP. So I have written one C++ program. It's a file, and then I'll give it to the C++ compiler. Now that compiler will be a Windows-based compiler because I am doing it on a Windows-based system. So this compiler will take that first C++. If there are errors, it will tell you the errors. And if not, so it's going to convert it into a target code called as a machine code, target code, executable code called as first.exe. Getting? Now the thing is, you wrote this first.cpp. You compiled it on Windows. You got a native code, first.exe. But this first.exe can be executed only on any other Windows-based system. Can I take this first.exe and try to run it on Linux-based system? If I take this exe and try to run on Macintosh, no, it is not possible because this first.exe is bound to that OS only. Means it is bound to that operating system. Getting? And that is the drawback. Now you may say like, why this is a drawback in their project? Many might be having that query. In their project, that was a green project to control electronic devices. So in that project, why this is a drawback? Getting? I'll tell you. See, now if they are told to write a software which will control electronic device, example, washing machine I'm taking. Getting? This is one X company washing machine. This is a Y company washing machine. This is a Z company washing machine. Getting? Now tell me, every company, according to the cost factor and all, some companies make it costly by putting a better microcontroller. Internally, microcontrollers are there, not microprocessors. So there are microcontroller. Do they have their OS also? Chip burn OS. They are called as a real-time operating system, RTOS. So obviously that washing machine is also having a OS, but it's not a general purpose OS. It's a dedicated OS. Its task is dedicated. Clear? So it will have its OS, which is ROM burned, and that chip is installed in that washing machine. So it will have its own microcontroller and its OS. It will also have its own microcontroller OS. So is it necessary that every company, when they make washing machine, they'll use the same real-time OS? They'll use the same microcontroller? Not necessary. Like they are using microcontroller 8031, which is in history now, it's not available. It is only for study purpose. Like 8031, 8051, 8097, all these are study microcontrollers nowadays. Practically, there are different microcontrollers used. Okay? But anyway, are every washing machine making companies using the same architecture? Are they using the same OS? No. So what they will have to do, this Gosling team, if they write one program to control that washing machine, are they supposed to make versions of every company and every OS? Means for every new washing machine of new company, they have to developed a new program compatible to that OS and that microcontroller. A difficult task. So what they want is program will write one only, but it should be executed on any system. Means write once, run anywhere. That was the principle. You understanding? Write once and run anywhere. That was their goal, which they couldn't achieve it using C++. I hope you are hearing me very carefully. Those who are hearing carefully, you'll sure understand everything properly. Huh? Don't worry. Don't just get distracted. That's the thing, because online mode, I know you have lot of problems with it, but if you focus it, you'll understand. Okay, so now this exe, you understanding? If I run it on a Windows system, it will run because it is Windows compatible. Any other Windows system, getting like if you have developed it on Windows 7 and you try to do it on 7, 8 or 10 or other versions, it will run, no problem. But if I try to run it on a Macintosh or if I try to run it on a Linux, it won't. You should know it, like those who have worked on Linux system, you know it, when you write a C++ program or C, you get a dot out file. Whereas the extension for Mac is something different. You understanding or no? Clear? So what the thing is clear to you, that if you develop one program for one system, it can be run only on those systems. It cannot be done cross execution. It is called as a cross execution. Like developed for Windows, but possible to run on Mac also and Linux also. Getting? Means if I want to run this program on Mac, am I supposed to compile it for Mac system separately using Mac C compiler? If I want to run on Linux, am I supposed to compile it on Linux separately using Linux C compiler? Yes. Means you have to build that exes for every system separately. One exe only won't be possible for all system. So that is one drawback. Got it? So now if I try to run this exe on Windows, it will run. But will it run on Mac? Will it run on Linux system? No. So that is the drawback. Get it? And one last drawback is pointers.
Sir,
Clear? Huh? Yes.
सर आप लास्ट टाइम सर तुम्ही म्हटलेले की सगळे जे जीएनयूचंच कंपायलर यूज करतात.
Yes. GNU, maximum time we use GNU compilers. Getting it?
हां
But
सर.
that GNU compilers also, they have made it for Windows, for Linux. Though it's a GNU compiler, but it is also not plat. GNU compilers they have developed for Windows. GNU compilers they have developed for Linux. GNU compilers they have developed for Mac. You are getting what I'm trying to say?
Yes.
So ultimately, the exe which you will get after compiling, you cannot cross it. Means I cannot take that exe and directly try to run on Mac. I cannot take that exe and directly try to run on Linux. If I want to run, then I have to give to Linux compiler. And GNU has developed a Linux compiler also. GNU has developed a Mac compiler. They have developed a Windows compiler. So the same program, then I have to give to whose compiler? Linux system compiler, then I'll get a exe for Linux and then run that executable for Linux. Same is the case for Mac. But my goal is what? Compile once only and take the same exe and run it anywhere. You understanding? The same compiled code, I should be able to run it on any system. And that is the main requirement. Getting? For their project. Because as I said, now their project. If they are writing a software to control a washing machine, the same program they should be able to install in any washing machine, irrespective which microcontroller is there in that washing machine, which real-time operating system is being put in that washing machine, doesn't matter. Getting? One program only they should be able to install on any washing machine. So example washing machine, but it is applicable for other electronic devices also.
Yes, sir, understood.
Clear? Okay. Now you can see the history. When you are hearing about the history, you can realize that initially the language was for which purpose? For controlling electronic device. And when the history will get over, then you'll realize that Java is now a language of internet. Some people may be surprised where the controlling of electronic device and where it is now applied for web applications. Getting? Okay, now the fourth problem is pointers. Right? Now, what are pointers? That too I'll tell you. Right? Now pointers concept already you know. Okay, it's a variable which is containing address of something. Kidding? So through pointer do we get access, direct access to memory? Yes. And pointer is good also and pointer is bad also. Like if we are getting direct access to memory, you can create any hazardous thing also in the system. You understanding, guys? Okay. Means like viruses can be introduced in your system through pointer, because basically to create viruses, pointers are the main thing. Getting the pointers are sure used for introducing some viruses in your system. Getting means whenever some interrupt occur, so you can trap that interrupt, and through that interrupt, when it goes to the interrupt vector table, there you can damage that IVT and put some other code over there. But all this thing is possible when you get access to the memory, no? And memory access is possible through pointers. Okay, so it is an hazardous situation, right? Now Java like language don't give pointer, but there is a concept like pointer, but language Java never gives direct access to memory. Okay, so pointer's main feature is what? Through pointer you can access memory directly. And direct access to memory is always going to be dangerous. Because if you have access to memory, can we damage interrupt vector tables also? Getting? There is a concept called interrupt vector table, where the interrupt service routines are kept. So can I damage that IVT? Pictorially, I'll just try to tell you. Computer is an interrupt driven system. You should know that. Is computer an interrupt driven system? Means when I type something, when I hit a key, interrupt has occurred. When I put a pen drive, interrupt has occurred. When I'm moving the mouse, interrupt is occurring. Okay. Now, whenever an interrupt occur, computer gives the service to that interrupt. And for service, service routines are there. Getting? And all these service routines, addresses are kept in one interrupt vector table. Getting? So now suppose I hit the key, I'm pressing the key. So interrupt 9 has occurred. So what happens is your system will come in IVT at 9th place. As the interrupt 9 has occurred, so it will come in IVT at 9th place. There it will get the service routine for interrupt 9. It will go there and perform it and continue with the code. Now through pointers, can we get access to this IVT? And can we damage this address? And here, can I put the address of some other function in which any rotten code is written? Can happen. And now when interrupt 9 occur, it goes there. So actually it was supposed to go to the standard routine, but it will go to this malicious code. But all this thing, why possible? Because we get a control to this IVT through pointer. And we can damage this values. Okay, right? Such thing in Java you cannot do, because Java doesn't give only direct access to memory. In Java there is no provision to print the address. Memory address you can never print. Okay, right? And through this direct access to memory, can we introduce virus also in the system? Yes. So all these are problem things. Getting, guys? Okay. So I hope the drawbacks of C++ are clear to you people.
Yes, sir.
Sure?
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Now to overcome this drawback, right? Now they wanted to overcome this drawback. So they thought of, now what to do the replacement, like C++ is having a drawback. So what they thought of, that let's design a new language only, which is based on C++. Means syntactically everything is same. For loops, while loops, getting writing functions, passing parameters, data types, operators, everything of C++ only they try to get. Getting the syntax of for loop, while loop, do while loop, everything same. Clear? The data type same, operators same. So they what they thought of, ki language they'll keep it C++, because people were already knowing C++. The programmers were already comfortable with C++ syntaxes and all. Isn't it? Clear? But all the drawbacks of C++ should get eliminated. And they thought of coming with a complete new language. Okay. So as I said, Gosling decided to come with a new computer programming language. But such language which is syntactically same like C++, but with the drawbacks eliminated. Getting? They thought of coming with a new language which is based on C++, like creating classes, creating objects, then adding methods, all the things, data type, for loops, while loops, switch case, everything they tried to keep like C++. Only the problems which were there, they tried to eliminate. Okay, and they came with a complete new language. And that language was not initially Java. It was given name Oak. Oak from oak plant. In US, many office premises, like in our schools and all, many times we have Gulmohar trees and all, na? Everywhere. In my school at least, clear, Gulmohar, Ashoka and all. They are common plants in school premises. So in their office premises, na, these oak plant are common. And oak plant is used for making furnitures also in US. So they gave the name Oak. Getting? And Oak was a language which was syntactically based on C++, but problems eliminated. Getting? New language based on C++ with all problem eliminated. Like here, they removed multiple inheritance. No multiple inheritance. So no diamond problem. Getting? They tried to remove memory leaks by automatic garbage collection. As there is an automatic garbage collection, no problem of memory leaks will arise. Getting? Third, they tried to make it platform independent. How? That I'll be telling you later, don't worry. But they came with a concept of platform neutral. And platform neutral benefit is compile once. And after compiling once, whatever executable you'll get, you will be able to run it anywhere on any system. Let the system be Linux, let the system be Windows, let the system be Macintosh, any system you'll be able to run it. The platform and architecture independent they did. And last, they removed pointers. Therefore, no access to memory directly. Getting? So as the pointers are eliminated, obviously you cannot access the memory directly, and no direct access to memory, so no hazardous situation. You cannot create any malicious thing in the system. You cannot damage the system or introduce virus in it. Java is not a language for making viruses. For making viruses, there are other languages. Okay, so based on this, okay, you're getting. Now you may think, like, why the name Oak only, right? So James Gosling and his team, he was just gazing out of the window, from his office window, from his office cabin. Outside of the window, he was gazing, means he was just seeing outside of the, and within his premises, he saw the oak plant and he decided, let's go with the oak. Getting? So as he was gazing out of the window, he saw oak plant and he decided to give the name to the language as Oak. Getting? Clear? I hope you got it. Now, initially using Oak, some electronic devices controlling software was done. Getting? Even they used it in telecom system also. In some telecom system also, they have to control that EPBX boards, that exchange boards. To control that also, they wrote programs using Oak. Then even they wrote using Oak some programs for controlling electronic devices. Like, getting? So like for television system and all, for television system first software when they made, they gave the name to it as Star 7. Now, why name Star 7 only? Again, there is a history behind it. Okay, so Oak was used in controlling this electronic, this television system. The project name was Star 7. Meantime, they gave some time for Oak to get mature. Now, mature means like your parents say, no, like let him become little mature. Now he's too young. Okay, after some years he'll become mature. So not that concept. Mature in the sense, let us make its library more powerful, its compilation more faster, memory management better. Getting? So to enhance the library, to enhance the compilation process, memory management process, everything, make it more better. Getting? So that is called maturing. So meantime, they gave Oak the time to get mature. Now, mature means, I hope from the picture you are realizing, initially it was a small plant, and then by putting water and all the things, getting? So when you're putting, feeding something, so it grows it into a big plant. So in programming concept, we try to develop some more libraries, compilation faster. Okay. But meantime, when this whole thing was happening, they realized that there is a copyright issue. Someone has already claimed. Oak was already a copyrighted name for their product. Someone already had a product with the name Oak. So now the issue of copyright came. So as the issue of copyright came, they were supposed to do the naming ceremony again. Initially, they did the naming ceremony. In Marathi, we called a Barshacha Karyakram. So that Barshacha Karyakram happened first. Now they were supposed to do again a new name. And what was that new name? That we are going to discuss it in the next session. But I hope in today's session, whatever I told, that is clear. Yes, guys? So in the next session, I'll be telling you about what was the
Sir.
new name given to Oak, that was Java. And then I'll be telling you about how Java became a language of internet. Means from
Sir.
controlling electronic devices to becoming a language of internet. Getting? So all that I'll be telling you in the next session. Yes, someone was asking something.
Sir, C++ drawback screenshot घ्यायचा आहे मला.
Okay. Don't worry, I'll be uploading all the recordings. Don't worry.
ओके सर
Clear? All the recordings, those who have missed, some people might have
ओके
missed
सर
today, they might have joined late. So I'll be putting the recordings every day on YouTube. You can watch there. Clear? Okay. So don't worry. Whatever is possible from my side, I'll be giving you. Okay? Okay. So for
ओके सर
today, we will stop all of you.